Hi, sweetie.
It's certainly rewarding raising children and watching our families grow.
Is the egg good?
But it's not always easy.
We have been running out of everything.
If you're looking for answers, this is the show for you.
You got him?
Yes.
In this tough economy, how can you save at the grocery store?
Thank you.
If you have a bag of cookies on the kitchen table, that's what they're going
to
eat.
Getting children to put more green on their plate.
A couple small carrots.
White House Chef Sam Kass gives us a tour of the First Lady's kitchen garden.
See them down there?
Yeah.
We'll introduce you to one super mom.
That was when Cole was born.
She's the only woman in Congress ever to give birth twice while in office. And then?
And now we just need something fun in the middle.
We'll take you to a place too sweet to believe.
Hi, I'm Lisa Sylvester, and welcome to Family Solutions. We have heard the debates. Can women have it all? Representative Kathy McMorris Rogers is a rising star in the GOP, and she's often seen front and center at news conferences on Capitol Hill. But when she's not pushing legislation, she's busy pushing a stroller.
Messaging. Moving forward.
There are 435 members of the House of Representatives.
We have some work to do.
76 of them are women.
Okay.
But only one woman in the House Republican leadership.
Messaging themes.
Congresswoman Kathy McMorris Rogers.
Tendencies increasing for that.
Who represents Eastern Washington State.
So what's been the highlight so far?
To say that she has a busy job.
Yeah, busy week.
Is an understatement.
Probably go through all of it?
She has one foot on each coast.
They go
into
all
the committee.
Shuttling back and forth.
Almost what he usually covers.
But she's more than an elected official. She's also a mom.
These are his little feet. It's 6 weeks.
That was when Cole was born. This is the first time I brought him to the Capitol. So he was just a little guy.
She holds the distinction of being the only member of Congress in history to give birth twice while in office.
I was first elected to Congress in 2004, and I was still single. Met Brian a year later. We got married. And then soon after that, I was pregnant. Cole was born in 2007. And Grace was born then in 2010.
One-year-old Grace and five-year-old Cole. Cole, who loves rocking out to Bruce Springsteen, who is a budding athlete.
That's his favorite.
I got it.
And who was born with Down syndrome.
That's tough news to receive. It's not what you dream. It's not what you expect.
Life has been a series of adjustments.
Look at that.
A pressing of the reset button.
Do you want the egg?
For Kathy McMorris Rogers and her husband Brian, who retired from the military.
I spent 26 years in the Navy, and so this is a lot like the Navy. You know, it's dynamic, it's very interesting, there's a lot of purpose to it. It's good. It's all good.
Your commanders are a little younger, though, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's true.
The family moved to Washington, D.C., but it's still a challenge trying to make all the pieces fit.
I love what I do, and I love being a mom. And it's a constant juggling act. And some days I feel like I'm handling it better than other days.
Becoming a parent has given her a new outlook. Having a child with a disability has given her a new objective.
Want a bite? There you go.
She is the co-founder of the Congressional Down Syndrome Caucus.
You want to be the best parent possible.
McMorris Rogers wants a new law that would let the parents of children with disabilities set up tax-free accounts, similar to a 401k retirement plan or a 529 college savings plan.
And just help them, whether it is maybe through furthering their education or housing or transportation needs that they might have. It just would give them some more resources to hopefully be as independent as possible.
And the ABLE Act will help achieve that.
Yes, you did.
It's an issue that unites even political opposites.
Good job. I met the lobbyist for the Sierra Club. On most issues, I'm not on board with the Sierra Club, and yet he has two sons with Down syndrome, and he said, you know what, I want to work with you. Show me your D. On these issues.
And these are really tough numbers.
To the world, she's a rising star in the GOP.
Okay. What are you doing here, bud?
But at home, she's mommy.
What does this say up here?
The Penn State abuse scandal has shined a spotlight on the issue of child sex abuse. Every year, more than 88,000 children are sexually abused in the United States. And the victims, well, what happens to them? In Ligdom, Virginia, there is a place where children come to heal.
Yeah. Go, go, go!
It's the first day of summer.
It's a little warm out here.
These kids are racing.
Let's go!
Something so normal.
They're having a great time.
For children who have been so traumatized.
All right! Yay!
The worst you can imagine that people are capable of, these children have experienced.
Keep going!
60 boys and girls who live at a residential camp in rural Virginia.
Look at that kick.
Ranging from ages 5 to 14.
Right here, yay!
They are all victims of physical or sexual abuse.
Probably 75 to 80% of our kids have been sexually abused.
Hi, sweetie.
They live here.
Sweetheart, right here.
Eat here.
How about beans and corn?
And hope to heal here.
All right, you need to go eat what you got, your salad, before you come back for cucumbers, honey.
Most of the kids don't come out and report that somebody did something to them because there's that whole shame factor.
The children's stories at the nonprofit Child Help Residential Center are almost too difficult to hear.
The scope of the problem is huge.
But you can see their angst.
You can see where the kids really are struggling with some of their identity in some of the pictures.
Subject to severe neglect, physical abuse, and horrendous sex abuse. Sometimes at the hands of a parent, a step-parent, or another trusted person in their lives. Lancaster says child sex abusers choose their victims carefully.
If they walked into a room, they could pick out which kids that they could probably groom and probably victimize. It's that loner in the classroom or the child that often isn't included in part of the group.
And sexual predators manipulate their victims.
From convincing the child that nobody's going to believe them, that they're going to lose friends, that everybody's going to hate you, to as things as drastic as if you tell, then I'm going to do something, you know, horrible to your family.
The advice for parents.
Listen carefully and believe what your child is telling you. And to inquire if you see them acting differently. And to avoid what's all too easy, which is to discount concerns because a priest would never do this or a coach would never do this.
When innocence and self-esteem are stolen, the center tries to build it back.
And this is such a healing place. You've got this 270 acres that used to be a horse farm.
The horses have stayed and now are part of therapy.
Behind you is some shampoo.
I think four-legged therapists are better than any two-legged therapists. Very confident building, especially for kids who have been victimized.
Just do it gently.
Gives them a sense of, wow, I'm not as small and powerless as I've felt at other times in my life.
When the children leave the center, either to return home or to foster care,
good boy,
they leave behind their handprints at the stables.
Some of these handprints are so small. This one is about the size of my son's handprint, and he's not even 5.
Small hands, hopefully leaving behind huge burdens.
There are many families out there still reeling from a weak economy, and a lot of folks are looking for ways to save. When Gina Linsicum's family went from earning 2 incomes down to 1, she realized it was time to get serious about savings, and she shows us her grocery shopping tips in our blog roll, Money Wise Moms.
Some things you can't control.
The water bill is $172.64. Our mortgage is $1,845. Homeowners insurance, which is $672 for the whole year.
Gina Linsicum, a Virginia mother of 3, has a goal this year.
Now we're really tackling those student loans, trying to get rid of the car payment by the end of 2012.
That means looking for anywhere where she can cut.
Oh yeah, we can buy this now.
Her secret? That you can save a ton of money at the grocery store by couponing and
get items for free through some of the store promotions, so that brings your cost down a little bit. And then once I add in some of the coupons that I cut out, I can get it usually down, you know, to 60%.
That's right, 40 to 60% off her grocery bill.
So I'm just spending a dollar or two for what I need.
She shares her knowledge in a blog, Money Wise Moms.
Those things. I don't need to buy the largest thing.
That brings her additional income.
But for successful couponing, you really want to match the coupon to a sale that's in the sales ad or at the store. You'll save more money that way. If you just cut something out and use it that day, you may save a dollar, but you could save a lot more than that if you go to a store that might double that coupon or if you can apply it to a sale or a store promo.
Let's go shopping.
She never buys chicken breast at the usual price of $4.29 a pound.
I know that the sale comes up about once a month because I look at those sales ads, and so I just wait. We eat chicken until we run out of chicken, and then I buy it again for $1.99.
One, and the cans,
right,
all for free.
So by waiting and holding onto this coupon, I'm getting 3 items for $2.
Stores heavily discount items at certain times of the year.
Here they are.
baking goods before the holidays.
You can use any of these that are on sale.
Barbecue and salad dressings in the beginning of summer.
You need to look at the print on a coupon, not the picture.
That's when you stock up.
Now my coupon is save a dollar off of two, and they're on sale for a dollar, so I'm going to get them each for 50 cents, which is fine. I'm going to use probably the whole thing.
50 cents for barbecue sauce.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty good.
And by the way, she's not just a mom who is really good at this.
So why would you pay two something when you can pay 80 cents?
Before I was a stay-at-home mom, I did grant administration at a university.
So this is a special deal.
I had to run budgets of millions of dollars.
And so in my ad, I saw this. My kids will be happy to see these.
Try to use that business sense and get us on a budget.
And since it's under 99 cents, they're going to double the coupon.
An average family of four spends as much as $1,200 a month for groceries.
So right away, it's $333 because it's on sale.
Gina says her monthly bill is about $450 to feed five.
That's our last coupon, and we can go to checkout.
There's certainly moms and grandmothers who've been doing this for years. It seems like it has trended a little bit lately that more people are interested in couponing.
Do you take competitors' coupons here?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. It's
certainly gotten a little cooler.
A penny saved is a penny earned.
Your total savings was $38.61.
For Gina, it's been a good day on the job.
It doesn't matter how prepared you are. First-time parents are walloped by the hard work of taking care of a newborn baby. But imagine if on top of the sleepless nights, you couldn't afford to pay for one of your baby's most basic needs. Diapers.
Just a few miles from the White House, in a neighborhood called Anacostia, poverty is so rampant that many mothers have to make a choice.
If they have to choose between feeding their family and diapers, they're going to feed their family.
People here, so poor, the little things we take for granted are out of reach.
You let me change your mother?
Naisha Davis is a single mother of three. Her youngest is three-month-old Talia.
She's a very happy baby.
That simple act of keeping her baby dry and clean is not so simple.
Before I had my daughter, I didn't know how many Pampers that I would really use in a day and in a week and in a month's time. Like, it's just a lot.
An average of eight diapers a day, about 240 diapers a month, at a cost of more than $100. Naisha can't afford enough diapers for her baby. You can't get diapers through the food stamp program. It's considered a hygiene item, often the only alternative, reusing diapers.
I'm the founder and executive director of the DC Diaper Bank.
Boxes and boxes of donated diapers.
You got them?
Yes.
All right.
Being delivered to Horton's Kids, a neighborhood community center.
Hi, sweetie.
Diapers are a necessity for infants. They're not a luxury. So you have a mom who wants to work, really has been trying to work, but doesn't have enough diapers to send her child to daycare, has to stay home with that baby.
Corinne Cannon became a mom for the first time in 2009. The first months with a colicky baby were rough.
One night around 5 a.m., I was up with him, had been up with him all night, and I thought, how do you do this if you don't have somebody you can call? And after we got out of kind of that hazy first 6 months of having an infant, we looked around and we said, what can we do to help families? What can we do to help other moms? I called the organizations and I said, what do you need? I can give time, I can give money. What do you need? I was blown away when they said diapers. It hadn't occurred to me.
So Corinne started the DC Diaper Bank, an idea that has been catching on nationwide.
We have been running out of everything.
She recently helped launch the National Diaper Bank Network.
Each one of these boxes contains 50 diapers. The DC Diaper Bank distributed 2,600 boxes in the last year. That's more than 130,000 diapers.
All right. Size two.
The diapers are donated.
You're welcome.
From individuals and corporations.
Yes, you got fives.
Other parents learn this is a need. They want to help.
Wipes.
I'm doing it so that they don't have to worry about where those diapers are coming from.
There you go.
They can have time with their baby and they can smile at that baby and they can know that there's a network there that's going to help them and support them. These are all our kids.
Hey, thank you.
That'll last you for a week.
Whether we see that or not, we are all one large community. I want to make sure that our kids are taken care of.
Parents and grandparents will tell you it's not easy getting the kids to give up the junk food for green vegetables. But I know one guy who might be able to help. He's Chef Sam Cass, who takes us on a tour of the White House garden.
Why have a garden in the White House?
I think the First Lady really wanted to start a conversation around our food, where it comes from, and the implication it has on our health, especially for kids. And when kids actually are empowered as actors in this, and they get to become part of the process of planting a seed and watching it grow and preparing it to eat, their minds just open up because they take real ownership in the process. And that can happen even just in cooking. And we have some cherry tomatoes over there, which are starting to come in now.
Does this stuff actually end up on the First Family's table then?
Absolutely. So I get to come down here every night, and I'll harvest something pretty much every night for dinner. You want to see a sneak peek of the first potato? These are little
Ooh.
Baby red ones.
Oh, wait, let's see. This is fun. So
good,
I bet
eh?
The kids love doing this,
yeah,
don't they?
Yeah, potatoes are always great for kids.
Because it's a treasure hunt. It's like the Easter egg hunt, except for
exactly.
potatoes.
The First Family eats anytime the president's in town, they eat dinner as a family. And it's a great way for families to use food to sit down and be a family. It's critical in getting kids to eat their vegetables, too. These plants are doing so well. Let's see if we got a bigger one.
Yeah,
there's a zucchini for you.
Thank you. You know, the thing about having fresh foods is it really does make a big difference in taste.
It is. I mean, you see, it's just, you know, so...
I know, juicy.
Juicy, yeah.
You can see the juice literally coming off of that.
Yeah.
This
nice,
is great,
right?
Yeah.
I am incredibly worried. So is the First Lady. Right now, 1 in 3 of our youngest generation will have diabetes in their lifetime if we don't significantly turn this around.
So yeah. How do you get kids to eat healthy?
I think really it is including them in the process. So when you go shopping, one thing that I know works is to say, okay, you get to pick out 3 different vegetables, right? So then all of a sudden your kid has a role to play.
Is there like a go-to dish that they really love or that the president really loves or the First Lady really loves?
Oh, that's a top secret information. There's no way I could disclose. No, we really balance healthy meals, and I think, but we also have a lot of fun with food, too. You know, we also have young children, so we make sure we throw them a bone now and again and serve just some fun stuff for them. But they practice what they preach, and there's, you know, balance on the plate. We cook to my plate, and then we go from there.
So where are the beets?
Well, we don't have any. We've already harvested the beets.
I heard the First Lady saying something about not being a beet family.
She's not the. Yeah, they're not the biggest beet fans, but, you know, we find other ways to use beet. We've grown beets a couple times, but it's not the most staple crop. This little thing right here, see it? This will turn red, but yeah. That thing packs a punch.
You're not going to eat
don't,
it, are
don't
you?
Let this. No way. Don't let the size fool you.
How did you meet the First Family?
My dad was Malia's fifth grade teacher back in Chicago, but I've known them for quite a while. Just I went to lab. I'm a Hyde Parker, so just known them from the area. It's a small neighborhood. Got lucky enough to come here.
The pressure surrounding children reaches beyond just academics and sports. In some circles, it also includes pressure to have a unique birthday party. As kids spend their weekends on the birthday circuit, how can parents find a balance? Photojournalist Bethany Swain invites us to a party full of creativity.
What kid would not want to have a birthday party in a candy store? So here we are.
We use your imagination just like they did in Willy Wonka. They get to pick their favorite candy.
The Charleston Chew.
And we make them a special candy bar cake.
All the kids get to get a slice.
It kind of tastes like a gigantic Twix with marshmallow fluffing in the middle.
Birthday set. We string the whole store into a spider web.
So this has to go under.
And they feel special.
Excuse me, I have to go under here.
And not self-centered, but special.
I'm stuck.
They all want fantastic birthday parties. They're all thinking them about it forever.
A birthday party for me and why I built this model and this business plan is about imagination. It's not about stuff.
This is hard.
The limos and the helicopter rides, the cougar, the tiger. I mean, those kinds of things are really just over the top. And I feel like, how do you top it the next year?
I'm actually going to make an ankle bracelet.
We're driving ourselves mad.
The wire's not edible, but the candy is edible.
I try not to feel pressure because I don't want it to become something that it's not. A competition.
You have to sort of stop that snowball because where are we going to go with it?
So when you get bingo, you scream, candy bingo. Okay?
It's really about the child and their friends and their family spending time celebrating another year of their life together.
We play games.
Sweet!
We don't need material things.
Finding out what works best for your family.
Yay!
We can have a simple birthday party and let them play, and it's all good.
62!
After all, we turned out okay. I think we did anyway.
Yay!
And that will do it for us. We hope you enjoyed our show. I'm Lisa Sylvester. Thanks for watching.